opportunity to welcome everyone to the Franklin Budget Finance Committee meeting, the regular scheduled meeting for Thursday, September the 11th. The first item on the agenda is approval of minutes from August the 14th. Hope everyone's had a chance to look at those. Any corrections or deletions? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Proper motion, a second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Second item on the agenda, discussion of water and sanitary sewer rate design. Mark, you're up.
I'd like to thank you for the opportunity of speaking with you today. Jim Marshall and Sarah are here with us today to go through a brief presentation and get the discussion going on the rate design based on the resolution we passed in August 26th board meeting. With that, I think, unless you have any questions to start off with, probably jump right into the presentation and,
okay,
and go from there.
Okay. And y'all should have a handout, brothers. Mm-hmm. A handout is simply what we have on the screen as well. We'll start with water and then work through sewer. Okay. Obviously, with sewer being ultimately the larger of the needs long term. Y'all have seen this chart before. This is the big chart, what we showed you last time. If you remember last time, we looked at a 3-year approach to get to recovery, 5-year approach, and then just take it as it comes. Five-year approach was adopted. So the hard decision has been made on both water and sewer. Okay, from a rate design standpoint, I now have a target on what we need to get additional revenue-wise. So tonight, I want to introduce really two options that are similar in nature on both water and sewer to get to full recovery for a 2-year, or to follow the 5-year period, the first 2 years of the 5-year period. If you look on the water, it averages about $350,000 a year. So that's roughly, we want to get about $700,000 of additional revenue in our first 2 years. Option A is to only get it in consumption. So in order to do that, to get an increase on all billable volume, we would need to go up 24 cents per year on all billable volume on inside the city limit customers, and then 37 cents on outside the city limit customers. And we're doing that in an effort to maintain the differential between the resident or inside the city limit customers and outside the city limit customers. Based off 2013 billing data, that would bring in roughly $711,000 of additional revenue. So right at that $350 a year number. And again, that's getting it only in volume. Option B, and here's an impact really of residential inside, what that 48 cents per thousand gallons looks like over the 2-year period. That's 2 years at 24 cents inside the city limit customer. And again, as a reminder, the blue line is your current cost to serve. The red line is where your current rates are, and this greenish yellowish line is reflective of the 48 cents increase over the 2 years. So this is where we would be at the end of 2 years. And then you see the same chart for the outside the city limit customer. Again, with the 74 cent increase is reflective of 2 years of 37 cents. That would bring in $711,000 over a 2-year period based off 2013 billing statistics. Option B is one that really takes a look at the customer charge again, and specifically how much volume you give away within that customer charge. So option B is a 16 cent increase on inside the city limit customers in year one. With year two, I'm proposing that y'all consider going down from 1,000 gallons included in the minimum bill to 500 gallons included in the minimum bill. So in year one, we would look to generate about $240,000 off the 16 cents, because going down from 1,000 to 500 would bring in about $450,000 of revenue. So we don't want to necessarily over-collect right out of the gate. So we drop the immediate impact to balance to get right around that $700,000 number. So the option B on the water side, you give folks a break in year one relative 16 cents to the 24 cents, but then you're coming down from 1,000 gallons included in the minimum bill to 500.
So really, you're doing that just for the customer?
Well, the customer, right now.
I mean, for the customer's benefit.
Well, it's ultimately, you're aligning your rates with your cost.
Okay.
And it really comes into play on the sewer side. Because if you think about it on the sewer side, the big thing out there is the looming debt service. That's fixed expense. You're paying the bank every month regardless of how much sewer you're collecting. So ideally, you're collecting that in a fixed revenue, right? One of the tenets of cost of services is to align your fixed revenues with fixed expenses.
Okay.
So this is, sewer is really driving this. And I wanted to plant the seed, not necessarily for year two, but certainly years three and four when the debt is coming on. I would like for that to be a serious consideration. That being going down on what you're including in the minimum bill from 1,000 to 500, and then ultimately 500 to zero. Doesn't have to be in a 2-year period, but there's value in being able to tie into your system, regardless of whether or not you actually use it. There's value in being a sewer customer, regardless how many times you flush your toilet. There's value in having that ability outside of the commodity itself. Option B, residential inside, moving to the next page. This is reflective, the rate impact, the rate curve. You can see we keep the customer charge alone, but we are going down from 1,000 to 500 gallons included in the minimum bill. And then we're going up 16 cents per 1,000 gallons for everything above 500 gallons. You can see that from a rate curve perspective, that yellow line closely mirrors the blue line, which means our rates are beginning to get in line with our costs on a per-unit basis. And then the same chart there for the outside the city limit customers, where we are again going down from 1,000 to 500 and going up to 25 cents. Again, these charts are reflective of 2 years of rate adjustments. On the water side, the next page is the summary of the options, just comparing them side by side. With option A, the left-hand column being purely volume, just trying to get everything in the volumetric charge. And then option B, you see there is a 16 cents with no actual rate increase in year two. We're just reducing the amount of water we're giving away, which is a revenue, it produces additional revenue, but you're not raising rates to do that. For it to be a rate increase, you're going up on the actual dollars that you're charging. And this is by reducing what you include in the minimum bill, you're simply adjusting your rates. It's not a rate increase. But your customers will be paying more. I'm not hiding that fact at all. It's just not in the form of purely of a rate increase. And you see option B brings in, based off, again, 2013 statistics, brings in just under $700,000, which, again, we're trying to get to that 350 average. So obviously, at the end of 2 years, 700 is the goal there. A key benefit of option B is that it's stable revenue. You know, you're going to get, assuming people use at least 1,000 gallons, you're going to get that increased revenue of that 500 gallons. And volumetric, especially on the water side, is going to be largely weather dependent. And you're purely tied to volume there, which you don't have a lot of control over how much it rains.
What is the average gallon use for the city of Franklin per household?
Right at 7,000. 6,213.
Okay.
$2.
$16
cents a gallon for 500?
Well, after 1,000 gallons.
Gotcha.
The rate's $4 per 1,000. They would add another 500 gallons to that category.
No, I'm just asking if you've got 500 gallons for the minimum, then you start having to pay 16 cents a gallon? Isn't that what you just said?
Correct.
Option B, you go to, at the end of 2 years, it'd be $4.14 per 1,000 gallons.
I'm talking about just for the people that only have the minimum charge right now.
It'd go from $11.86, you'd add $2.14. $2.07.
Wait, that's just for the 500 gallons. What if they were still getting the minimum, which say 900 gallons, instead of 5,000? You see what I'm saying? They were covered by the minimum.
If I use 1,000 gallons right now, I pay $11.86, correct?
Okay.
If option B were to go into effect, I'd pay $11.86 plus $2.07.
That's
only
for the 500 gallons.
No.
That's to get to 1,000 gallons.
That's 500 included in it. You're still, the 1186 still includes 500.
1,000 gallons costs $4.14 currently, correct? Or excuse me, $3.98 currently. If option B goes into effect, it's $2.07 for every 500 gallons, okay? So I'm paying, everybody that uses at least 1,000 gallons will pay for 500 more gallons than they are currently paying.
Yeah, yeah.
So it'd be 1186 plus half of 1,000 gallons, which is 207, so it's 1393. Checking on that out.
That's what I was doing. Maybe I need to ask you about it. Later, but I'm just saying, if you were covered by the minimum, and you're at the high part of being covered by the minimum, how much more?
Which is you pay. If I'm 1,000 gallons, I'm fully covered by the minimum, correct?
Yeah.
Right.
So the most
you would pay would be half. If we're cutting that in half, I'm now having to pay for 500 gallons if I still use 1,000 gallons, correct? So getting it for free, quote unquote, I'm having to pay for half of it. So half of 1,000 gallons is 207. So anybody that uses 1,000 gallons or more would pay another $2.07 a month, based off this scenario. Whether it's 1,000 gallons or 5,000 gallons or 20,000 gallons, it's still 207.
So the minimum use rate is 1393. The minimum use rate.
That's if you use 1,000 gallons.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Minimum usage.
Well, but the minimum.
That's not the minimum usage, though. Under this proposal, you get 500 gallons with your availability charge.
With the 1186 available.
1186 would be the smallest bill anyone would get.
In the news.
And they would get 500 gallons of water usage with that.
Okay.
As soon as they go over 500, they start paying that.
So do we know how many people are using 500? Or less?
We don't know 500.
I mean, I'm just throwing it out.
We have 1,000. We can give you that.
Those are people that will be affected, you know, and I think back to Ann's point, there was people with minimum.
Okay. We can get you that. We can tell you what that number is.
And I think that's what we're trying to hit at, how many people would be affected with that. And we're looking right here. Mm-hmm. Option B.
Okay. Any more questions on water before we get to sewer? The sewer options, exact same methodology, and that option A is going to be purely volumetric. Option B is going to be a mix of volume and reducing usage in the number bill. Just we have a greater need, so it's going to be bigger numbers. And then we're looking at roughly $1 million a year. And here, again, here's the, y'all seen this chart, 5-year approach. Trying to get roughly another $1 million a year in round numbers. So on water, we had a $350,000 annual target. Now we've got a $1 million annual target. Option A, again, strictly volumetric, is 46 cents a year increase for every 1,000 gallons. So we're looking at 92 cents cumulative over a 2-year period. So 46 cents a year on inside the city limit for every 1,000 gallons, over 1,000 gallons. And then for outside the city limit folks, 72 cents per year for every 1,000 gallons collected over 1,000 gallons per month. So that option A generates $1.94 million over that two cumulative over that 2-year period. So just under that $1 million a year more.
And that's what we want.
Right, we had that measured approach of trying to get $1 million a year. And that in large part was the conversation we had the last time, 6 weeks ago, I guess, since Aaron and I were here. So this is residential option A. This is residential inside you see that again, the blue line is the cost of serve, red line current rate, greenish, yellowish line is the rate impact of what these rates would look like relative to the curve. Going up 92 cents, so we go up from 417 really on the first 14,000 or the first billable 14,000, so up to 15,000 gallons, we go from 417 to 509 and then 338 to 430 on the outer blocks there. Anything over 15,000 gallons. Outside the city limit, folks, it'd be that $1.44 increase. But same methodology. Option B, and again, this is the mix of yes, sir.
The number of outside the availability, how many outside customers do we have?
In the sanitary sewer.
What's there?
She's pulling it up now.
Oh. 54, almost 55,000.
No, I grabbed the wrong number. Now, the only way we would have an outside the city limit water mark would be if it was coming in from, and they're tapping on before it ever gets to the city, right?
Grassland area.
Grassland area would be the outside.
Primarily.
The water.
The water.
Outside sewer customers, roughly 514.
Okay. You have about 21,000 total sanitary sewer customers.
Right. 500 of those are outside.
Yes, sir.
Sewer option B. What are there any more questions? Or can I clarify anything?
Does that 514 outside sewer customers, does that include the Grassland area? You know, where we let them tap on?
There's a portion up in that area, but if you go up to Grassland Market and all that, they're on septic.
Whatever was broken. All the sewer, the
Meadowgreen.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
Meadowgreen.
Yes, ma'am.
This includes Meadowgreen.
Yes, it does. Okay. All the active customers at Meadowgreen. Yes.
Probably about half of it. Yeah. So maybe a little more than half.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. On option B, again, it's going to be the mix of purely volume in year one, with the going down on the usage included in the minimum bill in year two. But in year two, just going down from 1,000 to 500 gallons included in the availability charge on the sewer side does not generate enough revenue because we're trying to get $1 million. So in year one, we're looking at the 46 cents inside per 1,000 gallons, 72 cents outside per 1,000 gallons. And in year two, it's a blend just to hit that $1 million mark. Our volumetric charge would go up 15 cents per 1,000 gallons on inside and 23 cents on outside, reducing the minimum bill from 1,000 gallons included in that down to 500. So we've cut the usage you're quote giving away in half, like we are recommending that y'all consider on the water side as well on the sewer, would bring in 1.92 million, based off 2013 statistics. What that looks like from a rate curve perspective, this is residential inside. You see the blue lines, your cost, and you see the impact here where we, you know, right out of the gate, we're getting enough money on the low end customers. They're paying their share here. Where right now, if you look, the blue line is the cost to serve on a per 1,000 gallon basis. The red line is what you're collecting, and the yellow line is representative of this recommendation. So right out of the gate at 1,000 gallons, those people are paying their fair share relative to their cost. Option B, again, or stick with option B, residential outside. You see the cost, and as we know, it's been the result of every study we've done, relative to true cost of service, that there's a, you know, in essence, a premium on the outside of the city limit customers, which this rate card reflects that, obviously. And here's the summary of the options. Again, option A is purely volumetric, brings in, you know, 1.94 million over 2 years. And option B is really the mix of volume in both years, adding in the fact that we would be going down on the usage included in the minimum bill from 1,000 gallons to 500 gallons. But we intentionally had them line up from an additional revenue standpoint. Option A and option B are going to bring in about the same amount of money when you consider the scale being within $15,000, $20,000 off of $2 million. You know, a dry month here or there, and those numbers are going to shift significantly anyway. And that was obviously very intentionally done on the water side as well. So we're not looking at getting really a materially different amount of money. It's just looking at different ways to get the money. And again, on the option A is purely volumetric. Option B includes a portion which you know, going from 1,000 to 500 helps stabilize your revenue stream with the thought that, again, a big driver of the long-term plan is the debt service associated with everything going on. Well, you're paying the bank every month. It'd be nice to try and guarantee as much revenue as you can for the utility to offset that fixed expense. And that's, you know, maybe option A is the ticket for now. Looking at and really I'm trying to plant a seed for years 3 and 4. When that debt service is, we're starting to see the true impact of that, and that's on the books, and we're paying it month in and month out. That's a big expense to take on, and I'd like to be able to offset that, or I'd like for y'all to consider being able to offset that with fixed revenue, meaning the availability charge, so you're not weather dependent on water or sewer.
Well, option B in both cases generates slightly less overall revenue.
Right, and again, that's based off 2013. So, you know, truthfully, if 2014 or 2015 is an exceptionally dry year, the volumetric charge is gonna, you know, in that 2 year period, if we have, putting everything in the volume, putting all our eggs in that basket, if it's a dry year, our revenue is gonna pace well above where we, you know, if there's a 15% increase in water sales, then revenue is gonna go up more than the 1.9 that we're saying. But if it's a particularly wet year, we're not going to hit the 1.9 that we're staking. And that's, it's a risk reward. And keep in mind, that additional revenue is coming from your customers. I mean, they're the ones that are paying. Whereas right now, option B, and again, you're stabilizing your revenue. You're not having to gamble as much on the weather.
With B.
It's less volume based.
It's less volume.
It gives you a little relief there. My thinking going into this was that we've just adjusted our, we don't do this in a vacuum. So we just adjusted our sanitation fee, our trash collection, recycling fee for the first time 4 or 5 years. That hits everybody the same. I would be hesitant, at least in these initial 2 years, to go back at an increase on the availability charge or to modify that so that people are getting less from it, at least these initial 2 years. I think ultimately you're going to need to come back and look at it, but I just think of the adjustments we've just made and that especially those who can least afford it, that might affect them a little more, and we have, you know, we did add $1.50 to the monthly trash collection fee and recycling fee this last year. So considering the landscape of everything we've done in the last year in our budget work, et cetera, I think that's a good place to go in terms of option A for this first 2 year period. I would suspect year three, you may want to go back and address the availability charge or that fixed rate component. That's just my general take and what I would recommend looking at it.
So is there an increase at all in A or B now if we did not do that, if we did what you said?
That's option A. No. Option A is what I described,
okay,
which keeps the availability charge as it is in terms of getting the 1,000 gallons and that, okay, that component of it.
So you don't think by not having a slight increase this year is going to, you know, we talked about if you don't have an increase and then they're accustomed to an increase right now.
You're still doing an increase.
Still doing an increase.
You're still increasing and getting the same target. It's a choice of where you allocate it. And option A puts it all on the volume side in terms of the rate and the increased rate per 1,000 gallons or whatever the basis we're using. And what would happen in option B is you would modify the formula for that upfront piece, that availability charge, and you would essentially, our customers would get less water for that fixed rate. And so it helps us get to the same revenue target. Both option A and B get you to the same revenue target. It's a matter of how you get there.
Right, and Eric, all of us being conscious of the decisions made on the solid waste charge, et cetera, I think Jim has stated that he's attempting to plant the seed for years 3 and 4, and then taking a serious look back at the customer charge or that volume.
So for the next 5 years, regardless, we want to see this increase.
Yeah, you've given us a trajectory,
yeah.
And that's what we projected out. We need to meet the needs of the utility and to be fully funded by ratepayers and do the work plan that's necessary. And we got there over the last 5 years, and this will keep us in sync with that over the next 5 years.
Okay,
that's
which is more palatable? I think
that's what I want your feedback on.
That's my
instinct is that A's the right place to go given everything that we've done in this last budget cycle. I look for your feedback on that. They're both logical. They both make sense. They're both consistent with where we've gone over the last several years in managing the utility.
But it would be more palatable, A, for our customers.
Well, there's less disruption than you have.
You know what
on the really lower end customer.
The lower users, who may be folks on lower income or more fixed income that are just using a small amount.
That's who I'm hearing.
That's where it may be more likely to impact. And that's what I'm factoring in when I say that to you is sort of that human element, that component of what you're thinking about and the other adjustments we've made in other places that impact people on costs they pay every month.
Because they really are careful about what they use. And they don't understand why they have to pay so much when they use so little. So I think that I agree.
Well, we only can't beat a dead horse anymore here, I think.
A.
That's not... overthink this.
You want a motion?
Well, if you want to make a recommendation, we thought it would likely be something you'd want the full board to hear in work session maybe 2 weeks from now. But the recommendation of the committee would still be welcome to that group.
Well, I move that we choose option A.
I second that so we can move on to the full board.
Mm-hmm. Second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
And this is just a recommendation going to the workshop itself.
We'll put it on the work session. It's the kind of thing I think everybody's going to want to weigh in on a little bit.
That's fine. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, item 3. One of our favorites. Update on death box. Thanks, Swat.
You know, if it's not our favorite.
This is just for Dana.
You promised.
He's got 45 seconds.
If it's not your favorite subject, it's certainly the most recurring subject.
Right.
Just very briefly, there's two pieces to the exercise that we're going through. One is to work on actually moving the swap to another bank, and the other one is replacing the letter of credit provider. We call it that. It's really a standby credit agreement. But just to give you a report on where we are, we have engaged the swap advisor. He is in negotiations with several banks regarding this. We know that we have three banks very interested in this, and we think they're going to be very competitive.
The rates appear to be very, very good.
Well, that's on the standby, but on the swap, we really don't know very much about what the dollar amount is going to be. And I will circle back and come back around to that. But on the standby letter of credit, we actually got 10 proposals, 10 different banks. And right now we're doing the calculations and trying to figure out whether it's better to go 3 years or 5 years with whoever the standby credit advisor supplier will be. We'll fill you in more on that at the next board meeting. We should have a resolution ready to move on that part of it. On the swap novation part of it, though, I doubt if it's going to be ready for the next meeting. It could be two meetings down the road before we actually have more of that, because it's much more complicated. You do have a lot to do with the standby credit, in that there'll be a long, tedious resolution to pass for that. The action on the swap novation is really going to be pretty simple. I mean, there's not a whole lot of negotiation to do that our negotiator has not already done. It's basically going to be giving him the authority to go ahead and make the move on that. So
when is that bank out? When is it gone?
The everything that we've seen that has been published has said by the end of 2014. So there's no frantic urgency in this.
It's other pretty urgent.
Other than it's hanging over us. We really don't believe they're going to be able to close it by the end of this calendar year.
We think our process will be done by October.
By the end of October. We think that they'll linger on for a little bit longer. But once again, we brought this to you so that we can do this when we're in the stronger position to negotiate, and not with a real short deadline. So that's the update on where we are with that.
I hope these are reputable banks.
Yeah, those three.
They're very reputable. They're very strong. They certainly have better credit ratings than our friend Mr. Depfa. But I would remind you that Depfa had the best ratings in 2007 when we looked at them. So anything could happen.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I never would have picked that for that name, Depfa. I thought that's the worst name I've heard of. Be careful about what you pick. You choose a good name.
Well, I have some German ancestry. So.
The Germans, they don't need it to sound nice.
Trust
they don't need it to sound pretty. Good. They just get it.
All righty.
Item four, okay. Status of bond issued for capital projects paid from capital projects fund.
When we get to the item about the quarterly reports, you're going to see several pages in there, and one of them gives you the status of the capital projects fund. It is in a deficit because we have gone ahead with the projects you have approved and spent money on those projects prior to issuing the bonds. That is not only the way that we customarily do it, it's really the right way to do it, because you have limits on spending out the money. So if there are any delays in the project, you don't want to get caught between the moon and the IRS on spending the money out in the time frame that they want. So it is customary that we would be somewhat negative in this when we're waiting to do a bond issue. We included in the packet, though, the reimbursement resolutions, just to remind you that the board took action in advance to authorize the project and more or less draw a line in the sand where we can go back and issue the bonds when we're ready to issue the bonds to do this. The other reason that we wanted to mention it really at this meeting is to just go ahead and get that kind of in the back of your mind, that rates are at a tremendously low level. You know, when we came and spoke with you last year and the year before and we did some refundings, we talked about how low the rates are. The rates are about a little over half a point lower today than they were then. So in our debt capacity model, we included borrowing somewhere between 13 and 15 million next year, actually in fiscal 15, which would already be this year, and then again in fiscal 17. We may want to do that sooner rather than later. We are having our financial advisor go through the motions of trying to look at where they forecast the rates. And of course, it's a moving target because the Federal Reserve keeps changing what they're doing. The unemployment rate drives a lot of this, as well as what's going on in Europe. So we'll just keep you apprised of that. But when you look at your quarterly report and you see that capital projects fund is underwater, I mean, part of the reason for that is we simply haven't issued the bond yet.
Fair.
Any questions? Item five, discussion of 2014 preliminary fiscal year end report.
Mr. Chairman, we like to bring the committee good news. And if you look at the executive summary of the quarterly report, You'll notice right now we're tracking in the general fund with preliminary numbers. They're unaudited, but essentially we're showing a surplus of $4 million. What we try to do is determine where did that amount come from. The one thing that was kind of new in the past year or two was the in lieu of parkland fees, and that is currently in the general fund, and it's $2.2 million. And when we get to the amendments, we're going to make a request that if we can move those monies to a separate fund, that essentially would be budgeted just like any other of the special revenue funds. So that's part of the surplus, was that $2.2 million. The next part was, with Hall income tax, we never really know what the amount's going to be. We had budgeted $1 million. When we got the receipt, it was $2 million. And what this is basically investment income, investment dividends, and essentially what it is, so essentially what we had is, we actually had double then what we were expecting. Then on the expense side, what we also had is, we were looking through to see maybe what we had budgeted and didn't actually come to fruition. And what we had is, in the talk, we had several capital projects budgeted in there, and when we had a change in the personnel, or at least the person overseeing that, we haven't spent as much. So when you put all those pieces together, that is where the $4 million surplus has come from.
Now, is it $4,027,840? Is that?
Yeah, I believe so. I believe that's the exact number, yes. Okay.
So when you net out the parkland revenue, that takes you to about $1.8 million.
Exactly.
Would be
$1.8 million.
Uh-huh. And you wanted to put this where, in a different
into a separate fund? Just like we have a facilities tax fund, just like we have a road impact fund, basically create a in lieu of parkland fund.
Okay, so yes. It will be named that. Okay.
Yes.
All right. When you do in lieu of, mm-hmm. I understand about the park. Well, no, I don't really mm-hmm. understand it, but what are you going to do with that money in that fund?
Well,
use it for parks. All right.
Yeah. You draw on it.
Is that what you do?
Give them certain projects and.
Okay.
You'd build a plan around using those dollars over time.
All right. I've heard through the years, in lieu of, you know, if we did affordable housing, something you put money in lieu of, where does that go? You know, where does all that in lieu of go? Does it go in the general fund?
We've got that identified also. That may be a separate.
It's in a reserve, and it's part of our fund balance. The difference is those are relatively small. I mean, we have a tree bank reserve.
Yeah.
We have reserve for this, reserve for that. Anything that we're holding on a short-term basis, we can create a reserve in the general fund. When you pass the $2 million mark, we think it's appropriate to set it out as a separate fund where it's clearly identified and we pass a policy that says how we're going to spend it.
We've got those other dollars earmarked. We know what it is. We're tracking it. So when those eligible uses come, whether that's the tree bank or whatever, it's there and available, and we know what's available for use.
All right, so who makes the decision where that money goes? Who makes the decision?
Well, in the case of the tree bank, you have authorized a group, including
the commission, right?
Okay.
The commission to do that. Yeah.
And the same thing with housing in lieu of, we will probably make a recommendation that will come before the board.
The housing commission might make a recommendation that would come before the board on a specific use or project or something that fits that.
In lieu of, money goes in specific areas to be used.
It is tracked separately. Okay. In some cases, it's an element of our reserve based on the amount and the timing of it.
Okay.
In this case, it's large enough that we think it ought to go into its own fund and be tracked.
Think that's great.
And remember, we are in a little bit of a holding pattern where we're reviewing that structure and we're identifying that funding. We're kind of holding that, knowing that the ultimate structure of that parkland dedication might look a little different than what it's written today. So. We need to keep it separate and identified, and then we can adjust.
We've authorized a study for that.
We're doing the master plan, but we're also looking at how that's structured compared to the master plan. So those pieces will ultimately work together.
Okay. Thank you.
Also, I'd like to highlight, I guess, some of the increases in revenue that we had the previous year. If you look at road impact fees, it was a 35% increase over the previous year. Facilities tax was a 47% increase. Hotel motel was a 15% increase over the previous year. Building permits was 36% higher. So as far as revenues, that in essence is how come we came up with surpluses in several funds in 2014. Also, remember, one of the things that was done by the board was in looking at some of the smaller funds that might have cash deficits, $1.5 million was transferred to some of these smaller funds, which did impact the final balance in the general fund. And maybe the third and last thing I guess I had to highlight is Russ had already touched on the capital projects fund and its status right now. And the one thing is, even though everything has been posted to the capital projects fund at this point, there are some anticipated reimbursements from the stormwater fund, water sewer fund, potentially the hotel motel fund for streetscape elements that potentially could reduce that deficit in the capital projects fund.
That's from the Hillsborough Road.
The Hillsborough
project primarily.
Yeah.
And those projects aren't closed out yet. They're close, but we don't have final numbers yet.
See, I thought I read someplace that we were, maybe I didn't, we were $109,000 on sales tax, local sales tax, under
the budget.
Under the budget.
Right. We were under budget. We are essentially 99% of budget. But if you look at actually over last year, we were actually 4.8% over last year's collections.
Okay.
But still under the budget projection.
Under
the budget projection. Yeah.
I have a question.
Okay.
On page 9, the drug fund. I was interested in the drug fund. 49% higher than last year. Tell me about that. Where did that come from?
Well,
where do you get drug fines?
People
that take drugs?
Well, I mean, in essence, it's actually coming, I guess, for offenses, drug-related offenses.
They have to pay them. Those people that are arrested pay the fines, and they're up.
Sometimes there are assets associated with drug trafficking or drug activity, and we can take possession of those, either cash or there's actually some furniture that the city came into possession of because of a drug bust. And so different things, it's very sporadic. It depends on the arrest and the action, and any assets that are associated with the criminal activity can come to the jurisdiction involved in that arrest.
I don't guess we'd want to sell the drugs.
We don't get to it. It's not legal.
Add to our fund.
Actually, they go into evidence and then they're used for reverse stings, but that's a different story.
Yeah. So our public
would
know that.
I one time delivered about $25,000 worth of ecstasy to the Franklin Police Department.
In your line of work.
Yes, in my profession.
Thank you for clarifying that. Yes.
That was part of my day job.
Let's clear that up a little bit.
You should have seen Detective Teague.
Okay, I have just a few questions. How long has it taken the parks in lieu of to accumulate the $2.2 million?
It's been a year or a slightly over a
it's
year.
It's over a year.
Yeah. Yes.
And there are a couple of very large projects in there. Both
yeah, there
apartment
was a,
complexes yeah. on.
Artesa itself was over $1 million.
The reason that I'm asking that is if you remember whenever the city got the authorization from the state legislature to impose a road impact fee and a facilities tax. In the facilities tax authorization, it has the parks in there. And it looks like that our facilities tax that covers everything, parks, police, fire, you know, whatever, that comes with increased growth was $3.8 million last year. And now we're saying parks has basically got more than half of that for itself with that thing that we have in the zoning ordinance? Sounds like it to me.
Would you like me to tackle that?
Well,
I'd love to.
I don't know that there's exactly apples to apples in terms of the exact same developments paying each fee at the same time, just because of the timing and certain projects that were.
I'm just asking.
Where they were, but, yeah.
One of the motivations in looking for money either from the hotel tax or from parkland dedication in lieu of money was the fact that the state that also granted us the facilities tax came back in 2006 or 7 and forbade us from raising the rate to keep up with inflation. So around that time, if everyone remembers, we had about a $5 million deficit in the facilities tax fund. And in analyzing.
That was because of the police station, but go on.
Which also happens to be part of the.
Fully eligible
money that was in there. So when we looked at police and fire and sanitation and parks, the staff believed that it was going to be impossible to fund all of those things on an ongoing basis if we were then capped and could not raise the facilities tax. We've raised the road impact fee twice since we've been able to raise the facilities tax. We still have a little capacity under the old legislation that we could still raise the facilities tax, and we have not done so. But when we arrive at a rate that's about, I think, 15% higher than where we are today, we will never be able to raise it again unless there's movement in the legislature. So the idea that the facilities tax can continue to fund all four of those eligible areas is probably unrealistic.
But are we thinking that parks is worth half of it? I mean, whenever you're talking about, as I say, police and fire, and I don't know what the other one was.
Sanitation.
Well, in the early days of that tax, if I remember right, parks got
You're right.
The parks got a disproportionate share of that money. In fact, some years they got all of the money. But in the meantime, as growth occurred, we were unable to purchase police cars. We were unable to do a lot of things for the fire department and for sanitation because the money was just not being generated.
And I think your question is a good one. I think it's one that will be an element of this review of the fee when we bring all these elements back together in terms of the master plan and what we want it to accomplish and what those dollars ought to be targeted towards. So how it fits with other fees people pay, how it relates to what the goals are of the fee and its structure to begin with is all part of that discussion. That's why we've put it under review, because we want to make sure it fits what we want for the community and what we expect out of park development.
Well, let me go back to more fundamental question. To be able to impose any kind of facilities tax fee, did we not have to get the express agreement from the state of Tennessee to do that?
As I understand it, it's not a tax. You know, the best choice for the city, in my opinion, is when a big development comes in that they set aside amount of parkland.
No,
I'm asking the question. No, I'm asking.
There's enabling legislation about allowing you to have a facilities tax fee.
That is correct, but it has to be approved specifically for you. Not everybody in the state of Tennessee can levy a facilities tax or road impact fee. We had to get specific legislation. In fact, Williamson County and I guess Franklin were the first two entities in the state who got the enabling legislation from the state to levy a facilities tax and a road impact fee. So my question is, if we had to get enabling legislation to even have a facilities tax for these things that were caused by growth, I'm just asking, how can we do this other fee?
Because it's not a tax, it's an in lieu of payment. If you can't donate the land, we give an alternative to to the developer to instead put money in the bank so we can buy land elsewhere.
Well, I guess.
It's not a tax in the way that road impact.
Well, I don't know. I'm just asking the question because I think it is a legal question, but I just know about that. Okay, my other question is on the, and I'm glad people from the transit are here. Did you know, last year when we passed the budget, you know, the fiscal year 14 budget, we said that we would, let me see where this is. This is on page 11. Transfer from the general fund, like $499,000. Remind me of whenever we changed that to $899,000.
When the comptroller said that we had the budget on a cash basis.
So what did that, what did that mean?
Alderman Peterson, if you look at that, the fund balance of $461,000, this fund typically would have a zero fund balance. That essentially is the amount of cash that needed to be given to the fund. So if you take the $461,000 away from the $843,000, they would be within the amount that was budgeted.
Okay. And so then for our budget, that was a kind of a one-time deal.
So how does that roll forward into the current year budget?
That's the reason I was asking, as I say.
You'll see the similar case in sanitation. And where else, Mike?
I believe transit and sanitation were the two. Street aid.
There were three funds that we had to make commitments in order to be compliant on a cash basis.
Okay.
And the reason was these are funds that are reliant on receivables. Right. So at June 30th, they don't have the cash. So general fund transferred monies over, so they would have at least a zero balance.
Right. Well, as I say, I knew that we had originally planned the same thing that we had done, I guess, fiscal 13 or something like that. And whenever I was just looking at this, that kind of jumped out at me.
Okay. Well, that's part of why we give these monthly reports at the back of the finance agenda, because if you follow those on a monthly basis, you can see throughout the year where everyone is in compliance with their budget, or we'd be yelling at them.
Well, I did not. This was the end of the year, so I could go back and look at what we had originally planned. I don't do that every month.
In the transit fund, where it says fares are over 8% higher, is that 8% more people riding?
Probably. Or is that it probably fares. Is. Yeah, I would think so.
And you haven't raised the fare. You haven't upped the fare, have you?
No, ma'am. We haven't upped the fare. That's been an increase in ridership.
Okay.
Overall, for the whole system, this year have had a 32% increase in ridership, and that is reflected in that fare number.
Okay. All right. 32%?
Yes.
Great.
Yes.
However, let me say, look at what the transit fares are, $94,000. We're actually paying, I guess, probably the $499,000 again. Mm-hmm. So for every dollar raised that the transit fare pays, we're paying $5 for every dollar that
the fare raised.
We're paying $5 for every one of those dollars.
That's correct.
One of the things that over time we've seen, and I can tell you when about 5 years ago that we were paying about 50% of the cost, and now we're more in the 30% range, if that's right, in terms of looking at that. This is a little confusing with the way the cash basis accounting has impacted us, but we've made progress in terms of what we're contributing to the whole and being a lesser share of that. Some of that's leveraging more federal dollars and then trying to increase ridership. So it's an ongoing process.
It is. Actually, this past fiscal year, 69% of our overall budget were grants. They were, you know, federal grants, and then the city's portion, and then the increase in ridership helped to lower that down to the 30% is the part that the city puts in, from general fund.
Good job.
From general fund.
And a lot of this is education.
It is.
educating people to ride on public transit.
It is, yes. We've had the highest ridership we've ever had. So we are excited about that and feel like we have a good synergy going. And then with the changes we propose will come in the near future to meet Cool Springs needs. And so we feel like we're turning a corner.
And you have a pretty good ridership from the senior citizens on Columbia Avenue, don't you?
We do. And something I'd like to point out, right now, and it ranges between 64% to 69% of our ridership each month are workforce trips. We're getting people back and forth to work, whether it's through our fixed routes or through our TODs. And we're servicing now about 34 major employers. And so getting people back and forth to work.
Good.
Yeah.
That's great.
So that's been a shift for us, which is a good thing.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Item 6, consideration of ordinance 2014-30, first quarter 2015 budget amendments. Mike?
To continue with the cash basis budgeting idea, what we have before you are 11 amendments that we're proposing. And the first amendment is the one we just spoke about in moving the in lieu of parkland funds to a separate fund. And what would happen is that money would be transferred over, and it would basically take board action to be able to use those monies to be spent. So that was our first amendment. The second one is, as we're trying to, I guess, let our departments know essentially on a cash basis where they stand, we also have included some reallocations in these amendments. So there were some personnel costs that were budgeted in general expenses for the 2% cost of living adjustment, and also for the phase two, the final phase of the compensation plan study. And so we're essentially taking that out of general expense and moving into the appropriate departments. Likewise, though, we're asking to reduce departmental budgets for savings that we had from retirement. So we actually had a higher amount budgeted within the departments. So part of the reallocation is actually to reduce some of those monies. The fourth is, when we were getting the budget balanced, we had some monies available from leases that the board has approved, the master lease, and we had some items that were under $25,000. And as we started realizing that there was some available money, some savings from retirement, we have went through, and so when you approved the master lease, it was only for items over $25,000. So there were funds now that we could let the department buy these smaller items outright. The fifth item is some of the things that have come before you for action, and it is where there have been kind of an excess amount over what was in the budget. So that's what number 5 and number 6 are. And number 7 is why I guess I asked Debbie if she might could stay at the table, is we essentially would settle up with transit at the end of every fiscal year. And what happened this year is, because the cash basis budgeting, we essentially were locked into the amount that had been approved. So what Debbie and her staff had come before us and made a request was for some additional funding, and I may let you take it from there, Debbie.
Well, we can tag team together. How about that?
Okay, you got it.
Well, and the reason for this is when we set our budget, in the meantime, throughout the year, we were able to obtain more federal grants than we had budgeted for. So because we did that, obviously there were increase in cost. You know, those costs, there were expenditures that related to that. All of our grant funding travels through, it comes to the city. And so it comes here, and then we work with Russ and Mike each month as far as those grant fundings. And we did have a couple of grants that did not come in time, and so we were trying to, that's where it's a timing with the cash issue. And so it does not in any way, the city is not out any additional funds to Franklin, to transit. This is all based on timing of the grant funding and the increase in grants we received and the increase in expenditures that those grants caused.
And that's sort of an expectation. I mean, you really need to, for grants, sometimes they don't always come, or...
Exactly.
So that's what that $169,000 is.
Yes.
When you want them to.
Right, exactly. That's correct, Alderman Bransford. And yes, we anticipated them back much earlier in the spring, and we got them when we got them. And so, but the city is not out anymore of the GL fund to us.
I've had that question, okay.
Sure, understandable.
And maybe then the last items, 8 through 11.
Well, wait, before you go on.
You got it.
Number six, I have a question about number six.
Okay.
That budget for IT, does that include that additional person that we have?
This is the lease on the software where we had a change order back 3 months ago.
So then we don't need to provide any more funding for the person that we voted to?
We really don't think we will because of all the vacancies, but that's going, traveling separately.
Right, and that's what you voted on that actually on Tuesday in terms of the first reading. It takes two readings. We wrote it like it was a budget amendment, but there's no dollars associated with it right now. It was just a significant enough organizational change that I didn't want to do it by resolution. We've done some of those that are by resolution, but they're fairly small adjustments in the organization, but that's a fairly large change or a significant position that we're adding. I'm like Russ, I don't think we're going to need to add money down the line given the vacancies and some of the other things going on in that department.
I just wondered if that
this reflects, yeah,
$150,000 included that. But that's answered my question. Thank you. I'm sorry.
And for the remaining, number 8 through 11, 8 again was a bid award. Number 9 is actually something that we believe will help the staffs in both the engineering and the streets department. Stormwater has always been a consolidated fund, but with some of the other funds like sanitation, we break them into divisions. So what we were thinking is, as part of the amendments, go ahead and put the portion for streets in one division and the portion of the budget for engineering in a separate division. So that's what this amendment is right here. Number 10 is another, it was where the Parks Master Plan, there was money budgeted last year, and essentially what was in the current budget was less than what would cover that. So we actually are increasing that. So it's basically carrying it over from last year. And the last item is, we were asking, I guess, trying to make sure we included everything that's occurred in the first quarter. And one thing we asked about CDBG, and we found out that what we had anticipated was a grant of $190,000-something. What we found out is we actually have received $264,000. So since we're on the cash basis with our budgeting, we thought we would go ahead and increase both the revenue and the expenses for that same amount due to the additional award to the city. And on this item, we might request a recommendation from the committee to the full board.
So moved.
Second.
Proper motion and a second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Item 7, consideration of resolution 2014-64, fund balance policy update for the general fund.
I'd like to ask Michael Walters Young to come up and join me. He's been helping me to work on this. Back during the budget presentation, we actually had put in a proposal for a capital funding initiative. And what that would do is that would represent 45% of budget expenditures of fund balance in the general fund. And what we're doing with this update is basically it starts out as identifying what those funds would be. Then also updating it to include how they could potentially be used, as well as would it be a transfer to the capital projects fund. So as you're looking at the update, it essentially is just making note that if this update were approved, that fund balance in excess of 45% of budget expenditures would be identified for capital projects. And then if the board then felt that it should be utilized, it could either be used in this fund or it could be transferred to a capital projects fund to be used there. And also Michael was helping me that, I guess, there was also something that came right after we had adopted the fund balance policy, a governmental accounting standard. And what it did is it changed the language on some of the terminology we used. So essentially, this update does two things. It identifies the 45% of, for basically that classification for the 45%, and also it adds in that terminology.
I thought we'd already done this.
Well,
you're translating it into your policy.
Yeah.
You set that direction when you approved the budget, and we went through the budget process, but we're now updating the policy to reflect that.
Oh, okay.
So you need a motion?
Yes, if we could have a recommendation. Yes.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
While I have Michael up here, I want to pass something around to you. It's something Michael worked up that is a front and back summary of what we do in our budget. So you just might want to take a look at that. It's a very informative, a good quick hit of information that you can share as you interact with citizens, et cetera. So take a look at that. And I don't know, Michael, if you want to comment any further, go ahead and say a little something about it.
Yes.
Yep. In the various communities I've worked in, I've always believed that it's the responsibility of those of us who are in finance and administration to take the most complex budget materials you have and boil them down so that everybody can understand. So this takes 300 or 400 pages and boils it down to two. It's straightforward. You get a good idea of what services you provide, where your money goes, and where your money comes from. So feedback is always welcome. And we're going to, I think, sort of test pilot this, and we'll get them in some of the places like revenue management and those the counters, and we'll get it up on the website and go from there.
Good.
And this is our first draft of it, so if you see other things you want to include or you remember from the budget discussion, let us know, and we can keep it fresh and add additional information as well.
So we have water and sewer, that information here, where we can see where the dollars go.
This about your general fund.
Oh, general fund.
Yeah, at this point, yeah. So we could do something similar for water and sewer, but yeah.
I think that may be interesting because, you know, with all that's going on with those two funds, I think it would be important to see that we're trying to get to the cost of service.
Sure.
Yeah. All righty.
I think this ought to go in the to everybody.
In the water bill,
you know, we're gonna make it. It's gonna be available to everybody.
That's not bad. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you put it in the water, this right here in the water bill.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I love this. You know, this little.
It's another way of communicating.
Right here, it's kind of like USA Today.
Kind of the idea.
Yeah, it kind of helps put it spell
it's
it out.
Not,
for
it's
you.
Not the Wall Street Journal. It's
Well, you still have a lot of people, you know, going to the website, but you also have, you know, like I said, a lot of seniors who may just want to read something.
Mm-hmm. And I just, you know, when your eye goes right, first your eye goes to the bill, and then it goes to that little box. And, you know, I like that very much.
Well, especially the little blocked in section that says the lowest property tax rate.
Absolutely.
Amongst the largest cities in Tennessee.
Mm-hmm.
So don't move.
What?
Then you maintained your position as the lowest city property tax. Yes.
Oh, we hadn't updated that.
The last increase was in fiscal year 1987.
Okay, we need to update that.
Yeah.
Well, I think I've read that. When I read that, I thought the same thing until I read it more carefully, and it talks about the operations. None of the property tax increase is going to the general fund.
But it does say that it is going up 3 cents.
We don't need
it says that. We didn't.
The 3 cents, so.
But you know, we, up until what, 5 years ago or less, we never had it divided. It was just the property tax.
Thank you.
All right, thank you for your feedback.
You're welcome.
This is great.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
This is great.
Thank you.
That's what I'll read after Judge Judy tonight.
Monthly reports. Let me just ask if any committee member has a specific report, or Eric, if you or Russ or Mike have anything specific that you wish to.
Russ is handing out an update on the permit fees. We're doing a little different format. This is consistent with what we showed you maybe a month ago,
Remember, we brought in the first 6 months of the year and we looked at permit activity and development activity? This is that on a monthly basis, so this reflects in, is this August? $31 million of building permit activity coming through the system and breaks that down for you.
This report's a little more current than the one I've been giving you that basically is just a actual versus budget report. And if you wish, we can continue to do that one as well. But this gives you a lot more breakdown and detail. And unless you object, we're going to start including this in the monthly reports.
Yeah, I apologize. This is July. This is for the month of July.
Well, I like that garbage container fee. You really get to see the detail.
Yeah.
I have no room.
So before we do, so the garbage container fee is just the new garbage container sold?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And they add them on.
Mm-hmm. If what?
They add them to the system. People come on, new home, they need a rollout container for the trash collection.
And they have to buy
the first one is
they buy their
they
own.
Purchase that.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Did we buy our own?
I didn't know that. I thought we bought the first one.
We probably did, but we did not. Part of what we went to and went to the new
the rollouts.
Pickup rollout is that we did not buy the initial can. So.
That's what I thought.
But these people do.
As long as I've been here, customers buy their can.
Well, new customers buy. But we were not new customers when the system changed.
You were existing customers, and it was a change in the collection system.
Yeah. Okay.
Just old people.
Any other questions or comments? Any other questions on the monthly report? Then I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I so move.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye. Aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned.
I really like this.
Yeah.